From New York, this is Democracy Now!
What happens when the next one comes along that's both very contagious and very deadly? We're in deep trouble. Deep. Much worse than this.
As the coronavirus death toll in the United States tops 150,000, we spend the hour with Professor Noam Chomsky, looking at how neoliberal policies left the country unprepared for a public health crisis. He'll talk about how Cuba's helped other countries during the pandemic, Israel's threat to annex the West Bank, and the upcoming U.S. election.
We're in a very dangerous period for the next few months. What happens may determine the fate of the country, the fate of the species.
Professor Noam Chomsky, political dissident, author, and activist for the hour. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. coronavirus death toll topped 150,000 on Wednesday, the highest of any nation by far, with California and Florida reporting single-day records for fatalities. With the virus continuing to spread out of control in the United States, researchers at Johns Hopkins University are calling for a reset in the U.S. coronavirus response with universal mask mandates, federal support for expanded testing, and a new round of stay-at-home orders and hotspots. And in an open letter published Wednesday, the Association of American Medical Colleges writes, quote, "If the nation does not change its course, and soon, deaths in the United States could well be into the multiple hundreds of thousands," unquote. In Texas, President Trump was photographed wearing no mask Wednesday as he toured an oil rig and attended a campaign fundraiser, a violation of Texas Governor Greg Abbott's statewide mask mandate. In Houston, Dr. Joseph Aron, chief medical officer at United Memorial Medical Center, said COVID-19 will continue to surge unless people adhere to basic public health measures like wearing a mask.
I'm pretty much fighting two wars, a war against COVID and a war against stupidity. And the problem is that the first one, I have some hope about winning, but the second one is becoming more and more difficult to treat.
Texas Republican Congressmember Louie Gohmert tested positive for the coronavirus Wednesday after he consistently refused to wear a mask in the U.S. Capitol, including in a committee hearing Tuesday where Attorney General William Barr gave testimony. Gohmert's diagnosis came after he was tested by the White House ahead of a planned trip to West Texas with President Trump aboard Air Force One. After testing positive, Gohmert returned to his office on Capitol Hill, where he told a Texas TV station he'd sometimes worn a mask in recent days.
I can't help but wonder if by keeping a mask on and keeping it in place, that if I might have put some germs, some of the virus onto the mask and breathed it in.
Asked by a Politico reporter for comment, an aide to Congressmember Gohmert wrote, quote, "Thank you for letting our office know Louie tested positive for the coronavirus." The aide added, "When you write your story, can you include the fact that Louie requires full staff to be in the office, including three interns, so that we could be an example to America on how to open up safely? When probing the office, you might want to ask, how often were people berated for wearing masks?" The unnamed aide told Politico. Texas Congressmember Kay Granger has gone into self-quarantine after she sat next to Congressmember Gohmert on a weekend flight. Gohmert said he'll be taking hydroxychloroquine, the anti-malaria drug that's been shown not to work against COVID-19. The drug, which can have fatal side effects, has been pushed by President Trump. Meanwhile, Texas Republican congressional candidate Wesley Hunt also tested positive for COVID-19 just hours before he was scheduled to greet President Trump in Midland. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has ordered a mask be worn anywhere in the House chamber or in House office buildings. Internationally, confirmed coronavirus deaths have topped 250,000, with more than 17 million cases reported. Brazil reported a record one-day death toll of nearly 1,600 Wednesday, even as far-right President Jair Bolsonaro lifted a ban on foreign travelers and demanded demanded a rollback of other public health measures. Brazil's official death toll is 90,000, though public health experts say the true number is likely much higher. In Mexico, coronavirus deaths have topped 45,000. President Andrés Manuel López Obrador continues to resist calls for a mask mandate, even as his government's health ministers urge Mexicans to cover their faces to stop the spread of the disease.
The Mexican government, as I announced this morning, recommends the use of face masks. But we've also been very clear, and when the explanation comes, some people get upset that we're not going to make it an obligatory measure from the Mexican government.
Vietnam has reported several hundred new coronavirus cases after months of recording no new infections. In Saudi Arabia, Muslims have begun the annual Hajj pilgrimage in Mecca, with just 1,000 worshippers allowed to attend under strict social distancing. Distancing rules. In normal years, 2 million pilgrims attend the Hajj. In Portland, Oregon, federal agents fired tear gas at protesters Wednesday as hundreds of Black Lives Matter demonstrators rallied for a 63rd consecutive night outside a downtown federal courthouse. The crackdown came just hours after Oregon Governor Kate Brown said she's reached a deal with the Trump administration to have federal agents withdraw from Portland, calling them an occupying force. Acting Homeland Security Secretary Chad Wolf disputed her claim, saying the agents would only pull out once federal property is secure. On Capitol Hill, the heads of Apple, Google, Facebook and Amazon testified Wednesday before the House Judiciary Antitrust Subcommittee. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg faced numerous questions about Facebook's purchase of Instagram. Newly released internal Facebook emails reveal the purchase was made to, quote, neutralize a competitor. Unquote. House Judiciary Chair Jerry Nadler said Google and Facebook have, quote, greatly threatened journalism due to their dominance in online advertising. Subcommittee Chair David Cicilline openly called for breaking up the big tech companies.
This hearing has made one fact clear to me. These companies, as they exist today, have monopoly power. Some need to be broken up. All need to be properly regulated and held accountable. We need to ensure the antitrust laws first written more than a century ago work in the digital age.
Congressmember Cicilline also warned the companies may emerge stronger and more powerful in the wake of COVID-19. The hearing came just days after Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos reportedly made $13 billion in a single day. The White House said Wednesday talks with Democratic leaders over a new coronavirus stimulus bill have stalled. Republicans have proposed slashing expanded unemployment benefits to just $200 a week. For the past 4 months, tens of millions of unemployed workers received an additional $600 a week federal benefit, but the program just ended. Meanwhile, President Trump openly bragged Wednesday of his administration's efforts to block a program aimed at desegregating white suburbs. Trump tweeted, quote, "I am happy to inform all of the people living their suburban lifestyle dream that you will no longer be bothered or financially hurt by having low-income housing built in your neighborhood. Your housing prices will go up based on the market and crime will go down," he tweeted. Senator Elizabeth Warren responded to Trump's tweet, writing, quote, "This is blatant racism from the President of the United States, and it's disgusting," she tweeted. Last week, Housing Secretary Ben Carson announced the termination of an Obama-era fair housing rule that required communities receiving federal funding to address housing segregation. Around 200 people have been displaced in Denver, Colorado, after local and state police closed down a large encampment where people without homes have been living. No advance notice was given before the Wednesday morning sweep of Lincoln Park. Around 150 tents were removed. One member of the Denver School Board, Tay Anderson, was hospitalized with a concussion after being knocked over by police while protesting the raid. The Pentagon said Wednesday it's pulling 12,000 U.S. troops out of Germany after President Trump accused Berlin of failing to spend enough on its own defense. This is Pentagon Chief Mark Esper.
I think Germany is the wealthiest country in Europe. Germany can and should pay more to its defense.
The troop drawdown drew fire from congressional hawks in both parties. Republican Senator Mitt Romney of Utah called it a gift to Russia. Senator Robert Menendez of New Jersey said, quote, "Champagne must be flowing freely this evening at the Kremlin." The Trump administration's quietly neutralized a small federal agency focused on preventing industrial disasters. The Center for Public Integrity reports work at the Chemical Safety and Hazard Investigation Board has come to a halt, with just one voting member left on the agency's board of directors out of a possible five. Without a quorum, the board will not be able to release the final reports from any of its 13 pending investigations. In climate news, new data shows communities in the United States with large African American and Latinx populations will be hardest hit from climate change in the coming decades. According to the Union of Concerned Scientists, U.S. counties with more than 25% Black or Latinx residents will face far more days of extreme heat than whiter counties by mid-century if the targets of the Paris Climate Accord are not reached. In Morocco, authorities arrested journalist Omar Radi Wednesday on what press freedom advocates call retaliatory charges. Radi reported on the role of the Moroccan state in big business and dispossessing farmers of their tribal lands. He's spoken out about facing harassment and surveillance. An Amnesty International report alleges authorities hacked Radi's phone using Pegasus spyware from the Israeli company NSO Group. Now a court has charged Radi with undermining state security by receiving foreign funding and collaborating with foreign intelligence, and now has charged him with rape. The Committee to Protect Journalists issued a statement that, quote, Moroccan authorities in the past have plainly tried to make any charge against him stick in retaliation for his work as a journalist, unquote, and called on them to release Radi and investigate any sexual assault charges in a credible and transparent manner, unquote. Omar Radi spoke to Democracy Now! Before his arrest.
I stopped cooperating with the police because they're asking empty questions and questions that don't respect the presumption of innocence. So I'm not playing this game. If they have something, they just arrest me and send me to the prosecutor and then to trial. But I'm not playing this Q&A game with the police that just want me to confess that I was something I never was.
Journalist Omar Radi's lawyers deny all the charges against him. He's reportedly being held in a prison in Casablanca that is COVID hotspot. We'll link to our full interview with Mo Omar Radi at our website, democracynow.org. And the funeral for civil rights icon and 17-term Congressmember John Lewis is today at the historic Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta. Former President Barack Obama will give the eulogy. Former Presidents Bill Clinton and George W. Bush are also expected to attend. President Trump is skipping the funeral. He also refused to pay respects to John Lewis while his body lay in state at the U.S. Capitol. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. When we come back, we'll be joined by Noam Chomsky for the hour. Cellist Sheku Kane Mason playing together with his siblings, sheltering at home. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. coronavirus death toll has topped 150,000 Wednesday, the highest of any nation by far. The hardest hit states per capita are Florida, Louisiana, Arizona, Mississippi, Alabama, Nevada, South Carolina, Texas, Idaho, Tennessee, and Georgia, a list that includes all seven of the original Confederate states. Today, we talk about COVID and so much more as we spend the hour with Noam Chomsky, the world-renowned political dissident, linguist and author, professor emeritus at the Massachusetts Institution of Technology, where he taught for more than 50 years, now laureate professor in the Department of Linguistics at the University of Arizona, author of more than 100 books. Professor Chomsky spoke with Democracy Now!'s Nermeen Sheikh and I on Thursday from his home in Tucson, Arizona, about the coronavirus crisis.
We should understand the roots of this pandemic. If we don't understand the roots and extirpate them, there's going to be another and worse one coming. So far, we've been kind of lucky. There are coronaviruses, pandemics, or epidemics are very serious, and there are many possibilities. So far, all the ones that have happened in the last kind of 15 years, either the virus has been very deadly but not very contagious, like Ebola, or very contagious but not very deadly, like COVID-19. What happens when the next one comes along that's both very contagious and very deadly? We're in deep trouble. Deep. Much worse than this. Much worse than the so-called Spanish flu, which ought to be called the Kansas flu by Trump's logic, originated in Kansas a century ago. We may be facing something much worse than that. There are ways of dealing with it. After the SARS epidemic in 2003, scientists knew that another one is very likely. They warned against it. They presented policies that could be carried out. They weren't implemented, in part because of deep institutional pathologies. But the drug companies were the obvious candidates for dealing with it, can't, by straight capitalist logic. You don't spend money to try to prevent a catastrophe 10 years from now. What you do is try to make money tomorrow. That's the logic of the system. So the pharmaceutical companies are ruled out by capitalist logic. The government could step in. The government, in any event, does most of the basic research and for vaccines and drugs, almost all of them. So it could have stepped in. Great laboratories, plenty of unlimited resources. But they're blocked by the neoliberal plague. Remember Ronald Reagan. Government is the problem, not the solution, which means we have to take decision-making and action out of the hands of government, which has a flaw. It's somewhat responsive to the population. We have to shift it to unaccountable private tyrannies, which are totally unaccountable to the population. That's the meaning of Reagan's slogan. That's the fundamental principle of neoliberalism. We've been suffering, the world has been suffering from it for 40 years. Except for the tiny percentage who've become super rich and extremely powerful. Well, that blocks the government. Nevertheless, there were things that the government could do. When the Obama administration took office, in the first few days, Obama called the Presidential Scientific Advisory Board, which had been established by George H.W. Bush, the first Bush, who had some respect for science. Obama called it. He requested that they put together a pandemic reaction program, a way to deal with a pandemic if it comes. They came up with a report a couple of weeks later. It was implemented. It was in place until January 2017, Trump came into office, first few days, dismantled the whole system. Nothing. That's part of the general wrecking ball. We have to destroy everything that Obama did. We have to wreck everything because it's the only way to look like you're doing something happening all over. So that went. Now, there were programs of U.S. scientists working in China with Chinese colleagues to try to detect and identify coronaviruses. Most of them are deep in caves. It's very dangerous work. Some have been killed, Chinese scientists. But they were finding them and identifying them and testing them. The Wuhan Institute of Virology is the main center for investigating this. Trump canceled the programs. There were simulations run of a pandemic as late as October 2019, warning of what would happen. No attention. Trump administration isn't interested. So when the epidemic finally hit, the United States was singularly unprepared. After that comes a series of grotesque inactions and actions. For a couple of months, Trump refused to admit that it was happening. Other countries were doing things. In Asia, Oceania, Australia, New Zealand, they were reacting. Some of it, South Korea, which was one of the first places hit, never had to go to a lockdown because they dealt with it rationally. They identified the places that were hotspots, controlled them, tested, traced people, looked for contacts. Countries pretty much functioned. Vietnam has reported zero deaths, and apparently that's taken quite seriously by leading U.S. specialists. Johns Hopkins School of Public Health, which monitors the international situation, records zero deaths from Vietnam, which has a 1,400-mile border with China. South Korea, Taiwan, New Zealand, Australia, doing quite well. And Europe, they delayed. They didn't act quick right away, but they did finally act. And as you mentioned, the curve has sharply reduced since March for most of Europe. Some of them, like Norway and Germany, doing quite well in this respect. People are traveling through southern Italy. It's treated almost like normal. It's gotten so extreme that, as you know, Europe has banned American visitors. The United States is such a pariah state that Americans aren't permitted to go to other countries. Other countries won't allow them in. This is kind of mimicked in a horrible way in Brazil. Bolsonaro just denies that it's happening. It's just a mild flu. Don't worry about it. Brazilians are strong. We don't care. So big meetings of right-wing Bolsonaro supporters dancing in the streets, spreading the virus, and Bolsonaro is fine. One of the really world-shaking crimes that's being carried out is the destruction of the Amazon. That affects the whole world, not just Brazil. I mean, it means basically genocide for the indigenous populations. Scientific predictions are that on our current course, the Amazon will shift in about 15 years from being a net sink of carbon dioxide to a net emitter of carbon dioxide. Sometimes called the lungs of the earth. Forest absorbs huge amounts of carbon dioxide. It'll start emitting them instead. A little farther down the road, the Amazon, under the current course, will just turn into savanna, no forest anymore. Devastating for Brazil and the other Amazonian countries. Devastating for the world. It's one of the main oxygen producers in the world. I mean, at every level, we are racing madly towards total catastrophe under the leadership of sociopathic fanatics. It's as if some evil demon decided to take over the human species and drive them to self-destruction. And much of the world is trying to counter it, almost all the world. But the United States and Brazil are the extreme cases of racing with dedication towards disaster. Going back to this election, that's the reason why it's the most dangerous, the most significant election in history, why Trump is in fact, this may sound outrageous, but it's true, Trump and the is the most dangerous figure in human history. The Republican Party today is the most dangerous organization in human history. You can compare Trump to, say, Hitler, the Wannsee Declaration in 1942 called for killing all the Jews, tens of millions of Slavs, not destroying organized human society. There has been nothing like this, nothing. Now, the Republican Party is, we know how they shifted. In 2000, you go back just a decade or so, John McCain, 2008, was running for president. His program had some pretty weak, but some policies directed to global warming. Now, the Republican Congress was beginning to contemplate global warming, policies to restrict global warming. The Koch brothers, the super rich energy corporation, got wind of this. They'd been working for years to prevent it. David Koch, one of the Koch brothers, died recently, launched an incredible campaign to make sure that the Republican Party would turn to denialism, and bribed senators, intimidated others with the threat of running counter campaigns against them. Huge lobbying campaign, AstroTurf campaigns, a massive juggernaut. The party shifted, dropped all of its efforts to deal with climate change. It's now a party led by denialists.
As you talk about this denialism and the science denialism, first dealing with the climate crisis and then extending to the pandemic, both threatening life on Earth, with President Trump now holding a daily coronavirus press briefing without the scientists. You have Anthony Fauci throwing out the first ball at the Washington Nationals game, the chief infectious disease scientist, who won't play ball exactly with the White House. So he's not in this coronavirus briefing. You have Dr. Birx. President Trump says she's right outside, but she's not a part of this news conference. Do you think reporters who are sitting in the White House briefing room should refuse to be there unless scientists are there and unless President Trump wears a mask?
Yes, I think so, and I think they should do much more. They should say, they should be pointing out constantly what I just said. We're dealing with the most dangerous figure in human history, backed by the most dangerous organization in human history, and give the facts, not only the pandemic, but the much more serious threat of environmental disaster and the growing, very severe threat of nuclear war. In my opinion, every newspaper should have on the front page an image of the doomsday clock. You know all about this, but every January, the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists gathers the main scientific journal dealing with these issues, gathers scientists, political analysts to try to give an estimate of the security, state of world security, started shortly after the atom bomb. It's been going on for 75 years. The minute hand is moved closer to midnight, or farther, it oscillates closer or farther to midnight, depending how dangerous the world situation is. Midnight means we're finished. Every year that Trump has been in office, the minute hand has moved closer to midnight. 2 years ago, it reached the closest it had ever been. This last January, the analysts gave up minutes. They moved to seconds, 100 seconds to midnight. Since January, Trump has made every one of the issues that they brought up worse. There were three major issues. One is, of course, the threat of nuclear war. Second, the threat of environmental catastrophe. The third, the deterioration of democracy, which does belong, because it's only with a vibrant democracy of informed, engaged public that we can have any hope of escaping from the two existential crises. Since January, Trump has succeeded in making all three crises worse. I mentioned the nuclear weapons issue, considerably worse thanks to Trump's actions. The environmental crisis, of course, getting worse as he continues to press for maximization of the use of the most dangerous fossil fuels, cuts back through his EPA representatives and others, cuts back on the efforts to mitigate the crisis through regulatory means. And democracy, it's pretty obvious. The executive branch has been essentially cleansed of independent voices, nothing but sycophants of the Pompeo variety, sent by God to save Israel. The inspectors general who were imposed by Congress, by the Republican Congress, to monitor malfeasance of the executive branches, purged. Trump, in fact, went out of his way to humiliate the senior Republican senator, Charles Grassley, who'd spent much of his career imposing these monitors. Attorney for the state of Southern District of New York looked into the Trump swamp, fired. Congress, turned by McConnell, used to be called the greatest deliberative body in the world. Now it's a joke. Doesn't do any deliberation. It does essentially nothing except try to race through as many appointments of young ultra-right judges as possible so they can pack the judiciary for a generation. And the only other thing it does is figure out ways to pour money into the dollars in the pockets of the rich, like the tax scam. That's the Senate, the greatest deliberative body. Proposals come from the House for legislation. McConnell just can't. Don't look at them. That's not the role of the Senate. I mean, this is so going back to that's why there should be the doomsday clock on the front of every newspaper. Show us what the United States is doing to the world, to itself and the world. That should be in front of everyone's attention. So, and there are many other things that should be done. There should be major protests now everywhere against the use of military force to occupy American cities and to crush peaceful dissidents. This is intolerable in a functioning democracy. We can't sit by and let it happen. Just let it proceed step by step until we reach real catastrophe.
Professor Noam Chomsky, when we come back from break, he talks about Israel's threat to annex the West Bank, the upcoming U.S. election, and more.
Like a sorceress, I slays foes and rivals who wanna come this way. They better pay attention or a pension, not to mention suspension from the microphone plus detention. Trey A.O.'s will vacate those.
swept away by the roots. One of their founding members, Malik Bee, has passed away at the age of 47. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. It's the Quarantine Report. We return now to the interview I did with Nermeen Sheikh with Professor Noam Chomsky.
Professor Chomsky, I'd like to ask about one of the immediate crises we're facing, which you've just spoken about earlier, which is, of course, this pandemic. If you could say a little, I mean, now many scientists believe that a vaccine will be possible for this virus. Could you talk a little about what you hope will happen in terms of access to this vaccine?
Well, first of all, whether a vaccine will be available is an open question. There are some pretty favorable reports, but the development of vaccines, safe vaccines, is a pretty slow process, and rushing vaccines through has dangers associated with it. There may be unknown side effects. Lots of problems that can be dealt with by slow development, but racing it through does raise these problems. Nevertheless, given the spread of the virus, it's imperative to do whatever can be done. Then comes your question, how does it distribute it? Well, in the kind of society in which we live, it'll be distributed pretty much the way the stimulus money is being distributed, or the way the bailout in 2008 was distributed. So that was the Obama administration, not the administration of a psychopath. So how was it done under Obama? Well, Congress passed legislation with two parts: to bail out the perpetrators of the crisis, the big banks, the ones who played games with derivatives and so on. Let's bail them out. And the other part was to provide support for the victims, the people who lost their homes under foreclosure. Well, let's do something for them. Half the program was enacted, the first part. The Inspector General for the Treasury Department, Neil Barofsky, was so outraged. He was writing articles, even wrote a book about the scandal. That was the good guys, the Obama administration. Now we're talking about the bad guys, the Trump administration, off the spectrum. That's what's been happening with the stimulus funds. One of the major funds, about 80% of it went to people who earn over $1 million a year. You just gave the figures before about the cornucopia that's flowing to the super rich, these others. Well, that'll be the way the vaccine is distributed too, if we retain our current social order. We don't have to do that. That maybe Trump was sent by God to Earth, but the system that we live in wasn't. It's humanly designed and can be changed, can readily be changed. The coming election could lead to a change if there's real dedication to getting rid of the malignancy in the White House that's destroying us, and changing the former political party, still called a political party, that backs it, the radical insurgency. If that can be tamed and returned to something like it was, we can get a stable government run by people who care somewhat about the population. And if popular activism continues, which has made a big impact, it's worth— the Sanders campaign was a remarkable success. Sanders joined the planning of the Biden campaign. It's had a big impact on the program. It's the most progressive program of any candidate in recent history, maybe as far back as Roosevelt. The climate change program is not what I would like, not what you would like, but it's better than anything that's been proposed by anyone. It was partially written by the activists of Sunrise Movement. The leadership of the movement strongly endorses it. If popular activism continues, it can ensure, or at least make it highly probable, that these programs will be enacted and improved. That's the key. That's real politics. Keep the pressure on daily, not just push a lever every 4 years. That's what has effects. If that can continue, we can escape from this crisis. There are ways to deal with the environmental crisis. There are ways to deal with the pandemic, of course, nuclear war. Yes, there are ways to deal with it. They're not insoluble, but you have to grasp the opportunity. Now, as far as distributing the vaccine is concerned, we're going to be facing real problems. One is the radical inequality in the society, which is going to push the more wealthy and privileged to the front. That has to be stopped. The vaccine should go to those who need it, who are mostly the poor and vulnerable. They're the ones who are suffering most. They should be up front. People in impossible, like the concentration camps not far from where I live on the southern border with Mexico. The pandemic is raging there. Prisons raging. All of these have to be dealt with. We're going to face another problem. The anti-science thrust of this administration has accelerated a tendency in the country to be opposed to science. It's very strong. There's a strong anti-vaccination movement, which says we can't take vaccines. They're too dangerous. There's a, you've probably seen a story circulating that the pandemic was created by Bill Gates, George Soros, you know, to try to control the world population. It's very widespread. A recent investigation by Pew Research Center found that among Republicans, of those who are familiar with the story, which is a great many, almost 60% believe it. I mean, these are people who listen to Rush Limbaugh, who tells his 30 million people in the audience, this is Trump's favorite newsman, just got the Medal of Freedom. He tells his audience, there are four corners of deceit: government, media, academia, and science. They thrive on deceit. Okay? Tens of millions of people hear that kind of thing. They see what you described in the White House with the scientists pushed to the side. We don't want science. Okay, they believe it. Not surprising. That's what people are inundated with. And coming back to the distribution of the virus, they may refuse to take the vaccine. A person who refuses to take the vaccine is not just harming him or herself. It's like a person who says, I got an assault rifle and I want to run around the streets shooting it at random. That's what it means not to wear a mask or not to take the vaccine.
Do people have reason to be afraid, Professor Chomsky, about a vaccine that's been developed at, well, in Trump's words, the name of the program, Warp Speed, that in his zeal at deregulation and in to get a vaccine, which so many people want around the world, that there would be a danger in the original vaccines?
Well, if vaccines are rushed through, there's always a danger. It means that many of the possibilities simply haven't been tested. That's what happens when you rush things through. Well, maybe the balance of costs and benefits says you should do it anyway. What are we going to do? We're talking about the United States, how to distribute a vaccine. What about Africa? What about Yemen? What about poor areas of Latin America? And what about the huge mass of deeply impoverished people in India? And what's going to happen to them? That's most of the population of the world. They get some relief from the World Health Organization. It hasn't been discussed, as far as I know, but something pretty shocking just took place. When Trump, as I said before, flailing around to try to find some scapegoat to cover up the fact that he's responsible for killing tens of thousands of Americans, one of his targets is the World Health Organization. First, defunding. Second, trying to destroy it. What does this mean to tens of thousands, if not millions, of poor people in Africa? The World Health Organization is what provides them with medical support and treatment for the many diseases that they face all the time. Now it's getting worse under the virus. What does it mean for Yemen, the worst humanitarian crisis in the world? Thanks to our providing Saudi Arabia with arms and intelligence so that they can destroy the country, large part of it. The population, they have a terrible pandemic raging. The World Health Organization is one of the few means of providing medical support for them. So let's withdraw it. Getting rid of the world, pulling out of the World Health Organization and defunding it is threatening the lives of huge, uncountable numbers of people. Why isn't that a headline? I mean, or even a small story somewhere. I mean, it's shocking what we're overlooking. So going back to your question of distribution of vaccines, they ought to be right in front. We should be doing something for them. Well, you know, there's at least one country in the world that is showing genuine internationalism, providing medical aid and support for people who need it. When there was a pandemic in Northern Italy, serious epidemic in Northern Italy, there are some rich countries to the north, Germany, Austria, which had it pretty much in control. They didn't send doctors. Doctors were sent from Cuba, the country that the in a poor country that the United States has been trying to crush for 60 years. They were able to send doctors to Northern Italy, as they've done before and elsewhere, not the rich countries in what's called the European Union. Well, that's the kind of world we live in. This is sometimes covered and discussed in the U.S. media. And what the way it's done is to accuse the Cuban government of using slave labor to enrich themselves. That's what it means for Cuba to send doctors to work in dangerous places to deal with the pandemic, as they've done many times before. It's true that the Cuban government takes part of the funding for this to use for their medical system, their remarkable medical system. So you turn that through the U.S. propaganda system, it becomes using slave labor to enrich themselves. This is the country that we are crushing, starting with a terrorist war, a vicious economic strangulation. Whole world is opposed to it. When it comes up in the United Nations every year, the world votes unanimously against the United States, one exception, Israel, which has to go along with the U.S. Everyone else opposed. Who cares? We're the global pariah state. We don't care about anybody else. But these are things that ought to be front and center.
I wanted to ask you about Israel. Thousands of people have been protesting the way Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has dealt with the coronavirus pandemic, also protesting his corruption. This comes as the United Nations warns Israel's threat to annex parts of the West Bank has hindered Palestinian efforts to control the pandemic. The UN Special Envoy made the remarks a day after Israeli authorities demolished a coronavirus testing center in the West Bank city of Hebron. Can you talk about what's happening there, both the issue of the coronavirus pandemic and Netanyahu's express attempt any day now to annex the West Bank?
Well, what's happening with the virus is pretty horrible. If you look at the records of the main Israeli human rights group, LM, they actually report cases in which settlers, what's called the hilltop youth, extremist right-wing, mostly ultra-religious settlers in settlements that even the government of Israel regards as illegal, but leaves them alone and supports them. Some of them did have coronavirus. These young, crazed militants broke into Palestinian villages to try to spread the virus. I mean, that's at the extreme end, destroying centers, as you described, is with the legal part of it. Going back, in fact, Israel's treating the Palestinians as it has for a long time, all of modern history, pretty much the way the United States is treating the immigrants in the virtual concentration camps south of where I live. The annexation, which they're holding off for the moment, basically formalizes policies that have been implemented over the last 50 years. This is both major political groupings. The Labor Party's pretty much disappeared, but it used to be the major party. So under the Labor Party, Golda Meir, Moshe Dayan, others, under the Shimon Peres, under the Labor Party, as under the Likud-based coalition, the same policies have been carried out, trying to create a greater Israel, which takes over everything in the West Bank that is valuable and integrates it into Israel with huge infrastructure projects, and ban Palestinians, of course. You can drive from Maale Adumim, built mostly during the Clinton years, a town east of Jerusalem, kind of virtually bisects the West Bank. You can drive from there to Tel Aviv without even seeing a Palestinian on a superhighway. So you take what's important, but avoid the population centers. Israel does not want to bring Palestinian populations into the greater Israel they're constructing. And that's what's called the demographic problem. Too many non-Jews in a Jewish state can't have that. So we want to avoid the population centers. Don't take over Nablus, other population centers. Take over the areas that are of value to us. There is a Palestinian population. Try to get rid of them as much as possible by making life unlivable, or else isolate them in unviable cantons, probably almost 200 of them in the areas that Israel is taking over, where people are cut off from their fields, from their olive groves. have to pass through checkpoints to cross the road. You know? Just make life as impossible as possible and try to limit the population and take over what's valuable. The Jordan Valley, about a third of the West Bank, take that over. Palestinian populations have mostly been removed by one or another technique. Set up a military firing zone so nobody's allowed in it. So you kick out the Palestinians, then you put in a Jewish settlement, tie it to the electrical water grid. Pretty soon it's settled by Jews. Do the same with the Green Park and so on. Now that's the policy for the last 50 years. Do it slowly, sort of under the radar, so outsiders can pretend they don't see it. But that's what's been happening. It's now annexation will essentially formalize it.
I wanted to ask what you would like to see happen here in the U.S. in the months leading up to this election, which you've said is the most important in human history. What should happen here in the country, in the U.S.? What should people be doing to organize?
They should be doing anything they can think of, demonstrations, protests, political organization, pressure on every pressure point you can think of to try to block the very transparent effort of Trump, backed by his party, to set up major military confrontations, which will be an excuse for trying to either eliminate the election or to affect its results so that he doesn't have to leave the White House. Also stressing the fact that we are in a major crisis. The pandemic is the immediate crisis. Meanwhile, the environmental crisis is growing seriously, has to be addressed now. We cannot wait. We must put into practice means to mitigate the crisis and overcome it, to get off of fossil fuels, to get to zero net emissions within a short time. All of this has to be done now. We have to strongly act constantly to try to prevent the crazed lunatics in the White House from carrying out nuclear weapons tests. That's the next thing on the agenda. Breaking down the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. Try to pressure them, if it's possible, to renegotiate the New START Treaty. If there's no Democrats win the election, they'll do it, even though it may be too late to get anywhere. All of these things have to be done right away. No let up. We're in a very dangerous period for the next few months. What happens may determine the fate of the country, the fate of the species.
Noam Chomsky, world-renowned political dissident, linguist, and author, joining us from Tucson, Arizona, where he's sheltering at home in the midst of the pandemic with his wife. Noam Chomsky is 91 years old. He's professor emeritus at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he taught for more than 50 years. Now laureate professor in the Department of Linguistics at the University of Arizona, Tucson, author of more than 100 books. To see part one of our interview we broadcast last week, go to democracynow.org. And this news just in, the U.S. economy contracted by a record 33% in the second quarter, and another 1.43 million people filed for state unemployment last week. More than 50 million people have filed for unemployment since the start of the pandemic. And that does it for our show. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Thanks so much for joining us.